Welcome to Sunday Assembly Los Angeles. I'm Steve.
And I'm Maxcina, and we'll be your host for today.
Sunday Assembly Los Angeles is a God-free community that celebrates a worldview grounded in evidence and reason. We invite everyone to join us as we do our best to say it with us, live better, help often, and wonder more.
Just so you know, the AC is on if you're a little uncomfortable, so that should change momentarily. Also, we're running the assembly shorthanded today as half of our usual team couldn't make it.
Really? Where's Noah?
On vacation.
And James?
At a conference.
And Sam?
Off planet.
And Aurora?
Don't invoke her name.
Okay then, today's theme is finding solutions.
So Steve, what's your favorite solution?
Well, I like a nice blend of Captain Morgan rum and Diet
Coke. That's not the kind of solution I was talking about.
Oh, in that case, it's in Edgar Allan Poe's The Murders in the Rue Morgue, where it turns out that
you kill him is actually the wrong kind of solution.
Oh, good, because I was about to drop a major spoiler for a 180-year-old book. But I do recommend reading that. The solution is completely ridiculous.
I'll add that to my list. I'm talking about finding solutions for building a better planet.
Well, I'm hoping that fully autonomous electric vehicles will result in huge reductions in greenhouse gases and pollution while saving an enormous amount of lives, time, and money at the same time. What about you?
I basically agree with you on that one.
Okay. Our speaker today isn't just hoping for solutions for a better world, he's creating his own.
Matthew Cameron is using thin polymer membranes to reduce CO2 emissions.
Marie Rivera will share a personal story.
Emily Newman will be giving us a reading by Walt Whitman.
There's a solution I can offer right now.
What's that?
Well, we aren't listening to any music.
That's right.
Yeah. Let's solve that by welcoming the Wondermore Warblers and getting to our feet to sing along. Please put your hands together for Fletcher, KT, Don, and Yari, or as we like to call them, Ground Control.
And Ben.
Oh, and Ben, sorry.
Remember doing Nickelback first? Okay.
Thank you.
Cheers for Pete.
Big thank you to ground control and our warblers and to everyone to sing along. They'll be back in a bit.
We talk so much about events coming up, we don't always have a chance to circle back about what we did. To recap just one of last month's events, we were able once again to purchase, prepare, and serve a hot meal to dozens of LA area homeless at Safe Place for Youth.
Thanks to Jeff Sargent for sponsoring this meal with a Smart and Final gift card, and to everyone who helped shop, chop, and serve.
Thank you also for bringing clothing. Yes, if you want to applaud that. Thank you also for bringing clothing and children's toys for Baby to Baby today and throughout the month. We have a really nice collection of donated Like New Essentials for kids and families in need this month.
Next month, we'll be accepting school supplies on behalf of DPSS's Outstanding Toy Loan Program, sponsored by the LA Board of Supervisors. It encourages creativity and fosters learning in a safe and supportive environment because children of all socioeconomic status should have access to toys and other learning essentials. If you'd like to participate, please bring backpacks and school supplies like binders, calculators, crayons, markers, and construction paper, and bring them to the August 11th assembly or any SALA event between now and then.
So while you're in the lobby, a volunteer may have asked you if you wanted to write out a milestone card. If you didn't get to fill out a card, we will also be moving through the audience with a mic momentarily.
Ash Gernak paid their last student loan off and is debt-free.
That's big. Fletcher and Maria's son, Felix, is getting married this month.
Someone who didn't put their name is so pleased to be back in L.A. after a year in Albuquerque, small town,
1970s.
Who is that? Oh.
Welcome back.
Yeah, it's over there. Who else has a milestone?
The milestone, I broke my first bone. I only needed 36 years to do it. I have an exit where I'm fine. I'm going back this next week. And it was really happy vacation.
Cool. We're glad you survived that. Anyone else? We have one over here on this side.
We'll see if it works.
Hi, everybody. I'm Meredith. This one's very small, but kind of big for me. James and I and Livy moved into our own apartment in May, and I ordered the couch before we moved, before we found the apartment, and it came last week. So we have a couch. Yay!
Hey, everybody. My name is Don, and I play in Ground Control. And I have another band, I had a band about 20 years ago, but we're getting back together. We're getting the band back together.
So, nice.
And we're playing in 2 weeks at Fay Do-Do. It's an all-ages show, so my daughter's going to be there. And so I just want to say if you guys, and it's free, I think, maybe buy a couple of beers or something, but I think there's no charge. It's at Fay Do-Do's on August 3rd. So come see me if you're interested in going to see. And it's just like there's going to be like six bands. It's kind of a music festival. So, okay, will do. Oh, and coming up soon, I'm going to the Ground Control has graciously allowed me to perform one of my songs that I wrote. So that's coming up. So.
Yay.
Yeah,
we're going to have that later on today.
Katie's in mine third year anniversary today.
Hi, everybody. My name is Sean, and this summer, as of August, I will be 12 years God-free.
Wow. Nice. You have one more right here.
Hello, everyone. My name is Mark, and I just turned 50 on Monday.
Wow. That's huge. Anyone else in the audience? Ooh, one more. A lot of milestones today. Good job, guys.
Hi, guys. I'm Ryan. Yesterday, I spent the day with a bunch of really cool people at the SSA conference and got to hear really cool talks about vulnerability and community, and it gave me some neat ideas moving forward with Sunday Assembly, so be looking for some cool things. Also, he won't say it out loud, but Reed gave his street epistemology talk yesterday, and it was great.
Anyone else? Okay, and also just to finish, I didn't get to add that Felix's proud parents and brothers will join him and his lovely wife to be in Hiroshima for the wedding. So that's gonna be, that sounds pretty cool. Hiroshima, Japan.
Yeah.
Right?
So if you brought any children and need a break from them, you can send them to the theater next door with our child care providers. We'll teach them about how to get through a crisis of existential dread.
Well, they'll actually be having fun with Bubbles, Steve.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh man, I want to do that. Do you think I can pass for six?
No, but you can have fun with Bubbles.
Okay.
That's allowed. You may have noticed a green dot on some people's name tags. That means it's their first time at an assembly. Please give them an extra special welcome. Since today's theme is about finding solutions, let's discuss with your neighbor your comprehensive, better than Jared Kushner's Mideast peace plan. Anyone?
Or perhaps a topic that's a bit simpler. let's talk about a way you expect the world to get better in the future.
All right, so please turn to your neighbors.
Every month we feature a creative work for your viewing and listening pleasure. Today we have a special guest. She's the education coordinator for the American Humanist Association in Washington, D.C.
Little known fact, SALA is a chapter of the AHA. We're very glad she's joining us for a reading. Please welcome Emily Newman.
Okay, hi, good morning. I'm gonna read Walt Whitman's Leaves of Grass. This is what you shall do. Love the earth and sun and the animals. Despise riches. Give alms to everyone that asks. Stand up for the stupid and crazy. Devote your income and labor to others. Hate tyrants. Argue not concerning God. Have patience and indulgence toward the people. Take off your hat to nothing known or unknown, or to any man or number of men. Re-examine all you have been taught at school or church or in any book. Dismiss what insults your own soul, and your very flesh shall be a great poem.
Matthew Cameron is a consultant, trainer, business developer, translator, trade show manager, graphic designer, engineer, and biochemist.
Is that all?
He's also been published in the Journal of Polymer Science with his paper, Fundamental Investigations into the Free Radical Copolymerization of N-phenylmalamide and norbinene.
I read that in my book club. It was really good.
Yes. He's going to talk to us about a cool new technology to take CO2 out of the atmosphere and how science and innovation can help us take care of the Earth. Let's welcome Matthew Cameron.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for the warm introduction. Glad to be here and very excited. So, just a bit about me. Obviously, they covered a bunch of the smart science-y stuff, yada, 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 blah, blah, blah. But, I also do other fun things. Like, for example, I'm a Mickey Mouse voice impressionist. Oh, boy. Hi, everybody, watch out. do you guys want to know what type of vehicle my girlfriend drives? It's a minivan. All right. Yeah. So, anyways, enough fun stuff, enough about me. Let's just hop right in. To it, all right. So what this paper was about and what the original investigation was into is we were seeking to reduce CO2 emissions from flue gases that were being burned by coal in order to create electricity, right? Now, flue gas itself isn't just carbon dioxide, obviously. As you're burning coal, you're going to have a lot of different elements that it's comprised of, but more often than not, the primary focus is going to be the carbon dioxide. So what we were hoping to search for was a thin polymer membrane that could select carbon, the carbon dioxide, but also let inert atmospheric pressures go through, such as nitrogen. So the reason why the entire process got started is in 2011, the EPA, Environmental Protection Agency, they reported 6.7 billion metric tons of carbon dioxide being put into the atmosphere. And, you know, everybody's aware of what's going on with the greenhouse gases and things like that. And luckily, that's being continually brought to the forefront of our attention. So although there are multiple different techniques that are able to pull carbon dioxide from flue gases, the problem that's going to be behind a majority of them is that they require a phase change, a phase transfer, where the gas is being pulled out, and the carbon dioxide that's inside of it is, they have to do what's called a phase change. So you change it from a gas to a liquid or to a solid, right? And anytime that you're shifting from gas to something else, it's going to require an intensive amount of energy. So that's skipping ahead just a bit of a precursor, so that way you guys can be not cyclo-dying from anticipation. So, if you'd like, I can do the whole speech in Mickey Mouse's voice. I feel like some people, given the right crew, that could really work out. You know what I mean? So, but in 2014, the Clean Power Plan was introduced in order to reduce emissions nationwide by 30%. So, next slide, please. So, as I already mentioned, the industrial gas separation exists in many different forms. Obviously, we're focusing on just the flue gas separation here. And then one of the tricky fun terms is we were looking for CO2 felicity, which is where it's the polymer itself was loving of the carbon dioxide. And there's a few different ways that you can go about this as you're developing the polymer, which is what the next slide goes into. So what we have here is the selectivity as you're actually creating the polymer is going to be focused on, So we worked in collaboration with Oak Ridge National Laboratory, which is going to be inside of the United States, one of the largest research centers inside. So what we were looking at was something called the Robeson bound. This bound itself is where you're looking at the selectivity versus permeability of the nitrogen versus the carbon dioxide. So you can see up here that the Robeson bound, it has actually shifted from different time based on the development of polymers throughout time. So Robeson, who was one of the original geniuses behind it, and just to give a little bit of a background on polymer chemistry and the current research of macromolecules inside of its current state, is it's still relatively new in comparison to chemistry. You know, you think of chemistry, it's been around for forever, the elements, yada, yada, yada. But the development of macromolecules to actually selectively have the correct micrometer size to have the ability to collect carbon dioxide versus inert nitrogen is very new. It's on the forefront still of a lot of the technology. And even though this is a few years old, it's still something that's pushing forward. So what we had done in order to develop this membrane itself, and we'll go ahead and move on to the next slide, is we looked at different types of initial monomers, right? So what we were looking to do was, you see here norbornenes and cyclooctanes. So we did about 15 different types of initial monomers. And I know that this gets like a little technical, and jargony, so I try to keep it a little fun, but a bit of it's hard. So with the cyclooctanes, you know, this is the one where we did something called ring opening metathesis polymerization. It's called ROMP, and it's where it was actually a technically different way than what was generally accepted in order to make the polymers that we were creating. A lot of the polymers that were previously done, they weren't very high weight, they didn't keep complexity, and, you know, flue gas that's being burned from coal is going to be incredibly warm, incredibly hot. So we actually created polymers that were able to hold up of intensities of 360 degrees Celsius, which is significantly warm. So throughout each of these, there were different techniques, different steps. You know, we followed lots of research looking at different macromolecules like articles and research and everything. And luckily, of course, this was a collaboration between the University of Tennessee's Polymer Department and Oak Ridge National Laboratory. So we got to have both sides of extremely, extremely intelligent people who have spent their lives trying to develop different polymer membranes like this. So if we'll move on to the next slide, please. So what we did was film preparation, right? This is going to be the actual creation of the polymer itself. Now, there's a lot of different steps that went into creating both the catalyst and the individual monomers, because what we did is we started with one initial monomer. And what you had seen on the previous screen is that there were different types of chains, and that's because we had different synthesis steps. While I was studying as an undergrad at the University of Tennessee, I took my senior year, I was extremely curious whether or not I wanted to be a graduate student. So I decided to spend the entire year doing undergrad research inside of the polymer lab, which is the only one at UT. And then I also spent the entire year doing just graduate study courses along with the capstone chemistry courses. I really enjoy investigating and diving in. And this gave such a unique opportunity in order to develop these films. And it's something that I looked at as I was going into that department as an undergrad. So, you know, if any of you have children, you know, I'm sure some of you do. but, you know, I would really push and push and push for them to do undergraduate research while they're at university. It really is something that helped push me into an understanding that was so much more than just the undergraduate college level. But I digress. So from the film preparation, what we did is something called solution casting. So you can see on the left-hand picture here, you see a small little tray. So what we would do is we would prepare all the monomers, we would make them by hand inside of a glove box and everything. We would prepare the monomers by hand, create the catalyst by hand, because there were only, you know, a few different segments that were available, so we had to piece them together. Organic synthesis, organic chemistry, fun stuff. And, but so what the solution casting does is you create your monomer, you add your catalyst, but it's primarily inside of a solvent, which is just a liquid. We use something called tetrahydrofluoride, THF. And it naturally evaporates, leaving the monomer to, you know, just be wholly inside of the container without having any residual residue, because the evaporation rate of THF is much below room temperature, so it evaporates very, very quickly. And the polymers themselves that we were developing gave us, we were able to develop a high conversion rate and a heavy weight with about 5 to 10 minutes, which was very different. You know, a majority of the previous, if you wouldn't mind to go back to the previous slide, please. A majority of the previous iterations of developing these polymers was they had created very lightweight polymers that couldn't combine with itself, so the actual catalyst that we used was something significantly different. Previously, in order to do this polymerization technique, you would use a palladium MAO catalyst, whereas the new one that we had worked to develop with ORNL is a nickel antimony catalyst. So a bunch of fun words, of course, and but yeah, so those are going to be the differences there. Next slide, please. So that brings us from solution casting. So after the THF has had the opportunity to just evaporate, you have the polymer, which is left over. And then you can see in the center picture, it is actually a thin polymer membrane. But so then, of course, you think to yourself, well, how do you know what the thickness of that is? You know, how are you getting that so accurately? How is that reproducible? Well, we used a 45 micrometer syringe in order to put it inside of the mixture. But also, over time, we kept finding that we were inconsistently developing the film, right? You know, as we would measure it. So we started using what's called a doctor blade. This is where it just basically sets the height for you, and it does it on a thin glass layer so that way you can get the exact micrometer film that you're looking for. And next one, please. So here's a bit of the jargon where you can see the testing analysis. Now, as you're, the next slide, if you don't mind to go to that one, sorry. The next slide, the testing and analysis, here you can actually see the apparatus that we created at Oak Ridge in order to test the films that we were creating. So what we would do is that there would be two pressure chambers, and you only test for either carbon or nitrogen one at a time, because you don't want to have a mix of the two. And all that it is that you have the gas that you're wanting to test on top, And then on this left-hand section here, you can see there's just the thin polymer goes right in the middle, and then there's a vacuum on the bottom with an electrode that can pick up the sensor and the amount of like carbon or nitrogen that's being pushed through. So we developed it ourselves, but of course it came from, you know, looking at other builds and things throughout time. So if you wouldn't go back, mind to go back just one? Thank you so much. From here, we can see the testing and analysis. So we're looking at permeance, which is going to be how quickly it can actually pass through. And then you multiply that by the thickness, that gives you the permeability. And then all you do is you put the permeability of carbon over the permeability of nitrogen, and that gives you your selectivity, which is A. And then forward a slide. One more, please. Perfect. So these were our results, right? The exciting part, what have we been waiting for? So what we were looking to do was get onto what's called the Robeson bound. The Robeson bound was created, I mentioned a bit earlier, where they had the original initial bound, which was from 1991, and then it pushed forward again, I think, in early 2000s, as people continued to develop the new macromolecular membranes. So you can actually see on the left-hand side, this is the most recent version of the bound. We come very, very close to it. And on the right-hand side, you can see all of the different polymers that have been created before ours that were initially trying to hit that same area. So the four red that you can see in the very center picture right there is going to be our polymer films that we were creating. So from there, that's what gave us such an initial inspiration and an initial push. And since then, we've actually gone on to develop another iteration of that first machine that I showed that actually does a higher level of testing. But what was so exceptional about being close to that bound and what provided the ACS macro publication was the fact that we were using a type of monomer that hadn't really been investigated yet. So we were pushing bounds of a certain molecule that just hadn't really been looked at yet, and its ability to have a high selectivity and a high permeability are, you know, one of the greatest aspects. So then next slide. Gas permeability, right? Super interesting. It works really hard to capture all the CO2. One quick thing, since I've still got a few more minutes, is the iteration of the film itself. I haven't really talked about the applicability and how it actually gets put into the flue gas system, which isn't something I studied. It's more of the engineering side. But the applicability is that the best placement so far that's possible to be retrofitted is they have 90% reduction of CO2 from flue gas stacks. 50% of it is coming from a thin polymer membrane, as I discussed, that's similar to what we're currently doing and developing. So that 90%, it's a two-stage process, and that second stage is what sort of helps push it over the edge, but the second stage involves the phase transfer, as I had previously mentioned before. So as we continue to push in the realm of macromolecules, we're able to find more and more iterations of creating multiple polymers that are able to have better selectivity. And I really think as we continue to push, we're going to find more and more better results. So I do want to say a special thanks to the University of Tennessee and the Oak Ridge National Laboratory and all the team members that worked on this. Because of course, it wasn't just me. I was happy to be there, and I spent 10 months doing it. But there's all the references, of course, too. If you guys have any questions, the slides, I don't know if they'll be available online. But anyways, feel free to check it out. If you guys have any questions, feel free to give me a question. And thank you all so much for your time. And yeah, do you have any questions? So sorry. Sure, yeah. Sure. So the applicability of it is there are flue gas stacks, you know, as you, so, where all the smoke comes out. So what we do is that smoke, as it's passing up,
there's an area that gets vented over into a two-stage machine. The first stage of the machine passes over this thin polymer membrane, which selectively lets nitrogen pass through because that's good for the environment. It's inertly there. And the carbon dioxide is selectively captured because of this polymer. Right. Yep.
Wow.
Next time, that will be the that'll be the title. That'll be the title. All right. Yeah. Go ahead. Right. Sure, sure. No, I definitely understand. And the way that it works is they actually apply a set of air. It's so as it passes over, there's the film that's right here, right? They take a set of air that is clean from the boiler but heated. It passes across the top, and that movement of air actually helps the CO2 get pulled up into it to be recycled through the entire process again. And then also the portion that does get actually captured and grabbed from the film itself, you know, as it continues to cycle, parts of it get pulled down into the other phase transfer, like cryogenic distillation. So like basically they freeze it, and CO2 is a very reusable source inside of academia, so.
Interesting.
Yes. You know, I don't know of something like that just yet. I don't think that that's out of the realm of possibility, but usually in these type of situations, there's such an excess of CO2 that's being pumped out of these stacks. That's sort of what you need in order to capture it as much as it would be valued at. Yeah, oh yeah, no, for sure. I mean, if you could just, you know, everybody take one, you know, we all just do it together, you know, we could sing songs and do it, I'd be great, I'd love it, you know, like, I'm all for it, you know. All right, yeah, I will work on that, I will. All right, well, thank you everyone so much for your time today, I really appreciate it. If you have any questions, please see me afterwards, and thank you so much.
Good info.
Yeah, thank you, Matt. Matt will be at brunch and available for more questions. And ground control, you are cleared for takeoff. Please welcome back ground control.
Yeah, hey, I forgot to mention that I don't think I gave the name of my band, so. So the name of my other, this is Ground Control. The other band is called The Dons, because I'm not a narcissist much in my So The Dons, that shouldn't be hard to remember. So we're playing about 2-3 weeks from now, August 3rd. So we're going to be performing this song there, but Ground Control gets to perform it first. Maybe this is really a ground control song. This is called Everything to Me, and I was thinking about my kid and how I feel about my kid, and that's what the song's about.
Shelter and weather, I will.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Every month, an assembler shares a personal story about how they're trying their best in this crazy world. Today, we'll hear from longtime member and often our social media maven, Marie Rivera. Marie? There you go, lady.
So if you didn't hear any of that, not on mic, my name is Marie. It's Cole. And it occurred to me. I should follow? Yes. Can I sit?
Yes.
Yes? I'm allowed to sit?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
What's her name? Meredith.
You don't
right?
have a table?
Yeah.
No, I'm just kidding. Please. Jeez, can we get this over with? Thank you for trying your best, Meredith. Okay, I'm going to hold my phone for a minute so I don't overtalk this because I didn't know that I could have put up cue cards right there. That would have been really cool. I'm Cole, again, Anne-Marie, Anne Rivera. It occurred to me this morning that it might have been prudent to perhaps review other people's trying their best and figure out how they started these, because I don't know. But I will say that recently I had a milestone, and that was that I was in jail for 2 nights, which some of you know about, and it had me thinking about community, which is weird, but something I've been thinking about since I was 12. I'm gonna stand up. Good point. Anyway, Jeff, are you giving time or no? I don't know. It's something I've been thinking about for a really long time, because I had one of those typically atypical upbringings where my mom and my dad married each other, then married each other, then married other people and tried that too. And sorry. That would have been good too. Anyway, the point being, parents, the usual mess up, and me, an only child, except I had a half sibling that my dad adopted when I was 12, so that's a real salt in the wound, right? And I was always kind of a weirdo. I was a smart kid, which sounds like a humble brag. Or just a brag, except I bet a lot of people in this room have been the smart person, and you know how isolating that actually is. I started reading before I was 3, and I remember in 7th grade, Mrs. Elam just kind of handing me St. Edna St. Vincent Millay and just kind of like backing up. So kids, kind of, that was challenging, but parents and adults were worse. Adults are deferential to smart kids, and they let you make too many decisions. So, like when I was in 3rd grade, they suggested that I go into junior high, and that decision was left to me. And so my point being that as a kid, all growing up, my parents sucked, and I was an only child, and I made all the decisions. I started balancing the checkbook when I was 10. I was just always in charge. And I was always the smart one, so I didn't have a lot of experience with letting other people help or other people even trying to help. And there were glimmers of joy in that, but someone just helped me with this microphone. But
Anyway, I don't know what my time is because of all of the this stuff. Anyway, this last year sort of changed things. In the last year, I had all of the stressors that might show up on a checklist for life stressor events, like I was getting divorced from my really terrible ex-husband in the worst divorce ever. My dogs were taken away. I was being sued. That didn't even make top billing. My grandmother was dying. My mother was dying. I had to have surgery. Finances were bad. I was falling apart all at once. And all of a sudden, I needed people. And that's not really a thing I'm accustomed to or good at. And some people definitely stepped away, people I've known for 10 years and went on vacation with. And then some people unexpectedly really stepped up. Jeff went and picked up my prescriptions from CVS on a Friday from Santa Monica during rush hour traffic.
Oh my God. That's friendship.
I yeah. don't know anyone I would do that for. But, so I am a weirdo, and I need a lot of alone time, and I write, and I use weird words, and I'm hard to relate to, and I get all that, and I'm late, like I'm terrible in a lot of ways. But I'm loving, and I needed help, and people stepped up. And then recently, I was in jail, bringing it back to that, which, if you hadn't heard, I've been getting a divorce, and my ex-husband attacked me. I called the police, and they took me to jail. And so that was fun. But my thought at the time was, this is fine. They're going to let me out. That's fine. I'm very angry, but they're going to let me out. I should really let Fernanda know that I can't make the concert tomorrow night. And I had actually texted Jeff and another friend to say, hey, I'm pretty upset. Can I come by? I should let them know I'm OK. And my mom was having surgery. And I wanted to let her know I wouldn't be able to talk to her. I would be unreachable. Pretty calm about it. I'm good in an emergency. I don't get emotional, and I can handle other people's problems. So that was my basic take on it. Unbeknownst to me, all of you are at work, or many of you are at work, which is something for me to think about and contend with, I guess. I don't know how to signal to people that I need help. I don't know how they know I need help. I don't know that whole thing, that whole being with people thing, I think is just the biggest struggle in life. And as I got out of jail on, was it Wednesday afternoon? I came out and I saw somebody who looked like Ryan sitting on a park bench, and I thought, that guy looks like Ryan, and also, why is he waiting for a bus? And turns out that Fernanda talked to Jeff, and Jeff talked to so many other people, and they had made some sort of, I guess, task force to check on my car and raise bail money. And that was, so when I saw Ryan when I got out of jail, I was really astonished, and he made the point that I was in really good spirits, which I was, because I didn't know anyone was going to get me out. I was so touched. And a couple days later, I felt sad, and I had to contemplate it all. But in that moment, you're right, I was really well adjusted. I don't think this has an ending, except that I feel like I've been meditating on the nature of being myself and being with other people since I was 12 and reading psychoanalytic theory. And it continues. And I want to be a help to you, and I am going to try to figure out how to tell people when I need things. And that's me trying my best.
Yes. So. Awesome. We'll take it. That's us, right? Yes.
Thank you, Cole.
Yes, that was really good.
Yeah, and also thank you, Yari and Meredith, for helping out there. We are a donation-based organization, and we rely on your generosity and contributions to keep this community going.
So if you enjoy Sunday Assembly, this is how you can help keep it going.
Volunteers are circulating with boxes, or if you'd rather give a quick credit card donation, raise your hand so credit card concierge can, with a square reader, can come to you. No amount is too small or too large.
Don't forget that you can make it even easier to give by becoming a monthly donor, which makes you a member of Sunday Assembly LA, complete with fashionable green or sometimes, no, mostly green, yeah, name tag.
Sometimes wooden.
Yeah, I was going to say.
And most important, regardless of what or how you're able to give, even if it's your kindness and presence, we thank you for your support. It's because you're here that we have a community.
Yes. Before we stand for the last song, and I'll wait until collection is done. Looks like it's still going, which is a good sign. Thank you. A few things. Next month, we will be right back here at the Hudson Theater for Assembly on August 11th, where we will be shaking things up with some new music and a talk by Vanessa Gomez-Brake, who is USC Director of Religious Life and their campus DACA contact. And if you forget or don't know, DACA refers to Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals.
And on July 27th, we'll be participating in a kid-friendly beach cleanup in Venice with Heal the Bay. We've also got so much else going on, from Personal Growth Book Club, game nights, movie nights, family dinners, and pub trivia.
Be sure to check out our community board over there or SundayAssemblyLA.org for our full calendar of events.
We have to live here, but or leave here, not live here. That would be a little awkward.
We're not forcing you.
Yeah.
You can go.
Yeah. But we hope you don't go home. We'd be delighted if you join us for brunch at Spoonfed LA, just a half block west and a block south at 959 Seward. There's plenty of room and plenty of food choices, plus we'll have SALA mugs and T-shirts for sale as such. are we done with the collections?
Looks like it.
Okay. First, let's call the Warblers back up and help ground control with the final song.
Big Yellow Taxi.
I didn't sleep very well last night, so it feels like tonight for me. It really does. All right, you ready?
Yeah.
Some lyrics might be nice. Thank you.
They paid paradise and put up a parking lot with a pink hotel, a boutique, and a swinging hot spot. You don't know what you've got till it's gone. They paid paradise and put up a parking lot. That you don't know what
Thank you.
Awesome. Well, a special thanks to Emily, Matt, Cole, or Marie. Marie Cole. Ground Control, the wonderful, illustrious band that we always enjoy every assembly. All of our volunteers and all of you. Thank you so much for coming out. Don't forget, you can find us and share us with your friends on the interwebs. Until next time,
live better, help often, and wonder more.
Yay! Yay! Good job, guys. Thank you. Let's go eat.